Lord Jesus, we are so grateful to you for Jeff. I pray you fill his mouth now with your words. Cleanse his mind. Free it from anxiety. Give him your peace. May it rest squarely on his shoulders. Lord, I pray that you will open our minds, open our hearts to hear your word. Fill us with your spirit, Lord, that we might take home what you intend us to take home. We pray for your grace, your power, your mercy to be upon Jeff as he gives your word. In Jesus' name we ask and pray. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm not on? Well, all I gotta do is push a button. I can't handle it. I pushed the button. All right, now we're ready. Last week, when we got done, I took a moment and I apologized for the message because it wasn't what I felt it should have been. And what happened was I kind of got hung up on this idea of the female image of God. And as I was working through the message, I realized that it didn't exactly fit, but I liked it there. So I kept trying to put it in there because I knew in my heart that I could wrap it all together at the end. And when it got towards the end, it's like the Lord said, well, you had to have it in there, so go ahead and wrap it up. And I realized that I did not have near enough rope to wrap it all up. I had just enough to hang myself. So I realized that if I continued on anymore, it would have just been me babbling. You didn't come here to hear me babble. You came to hear the word of the Lord. So I just stopped. So I went back. And I said, Lord, you deserve better than that, so help me to fix this. So I have this is called Message on Mothers Rebooted. Okay? And I'd like to give you what the Lord has given me without me getting in the way too much, all right? So let's pray. Father, may I diminish, may you increase. May the words that come be your words. May the power come from you. And may you bless these people. What you have to say now. In Christ's name, amen. All right. Mothers. We talked last week about mothers are under attack. There's this whole idea of this super single mom who can do it all. And the myth of that, how that's just not true. And yet, our society and media continue to propagate that idea. So we see motherhood under attack there. And then we turn to scripture and we find ourselves, if you want to find out what a mother and a woman's supposed to be like, you turn to Proverbs 31, and that's what we're going to turn to today, and we're going to park ourselves in Proverbs 31. We're going to take a look at this woman of God who is just simply incredible woman. She does it all. She is super duper mom. Let's take a look at this woman and Proverbs 31, starting in verse 10. Proverbs 31, the last proverb in the book of Proverbs. Starting in verse 10, it says, a wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. That's how God views women, a godly woman. She's worth far more than rubies. And I think about my wife. You know, she did the dishes, swept, cleaned, did everything. Cleaned the toilets, all those noble positions that just showed that she was worth far more than rubies to me. And I just think, wow, we really need to take a moment and honor our wives and our mothers and just all that they do without any recognition. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. Tell you, a woman that you can trust, that you know that when you go off to work, that she's got you on your back in mind, she's taking care of things. So many marriages fall apart because that trust isn't there. So we have this woman who, her husband has full confidence and full trust in her. And he lacks nothing of value, nothing that's important. He doesn't lack anything because of her. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. She wants what's best for her husband. Just as the husband is the one who wants best for the wife. So here's a woman who is a good partner in marriage. Verse 13, 14 says, she selects wool and flax and works with eager hands. She's like a merchant ship, bringing in her food from far off. So this woman of noble character, of godly principles, and she plans ahead. She sees to the needs of her family. She's always got her other people in focus in mind. It says, she gets up while it's still night. She provides food for her family and portions for her female servants. She considers a field and she buys it out of her earnings. She plants a vineyard. She sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong for their tasks. She sees that her trading is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. In her hand, she holds the distaff and grasps the spindle with her fingers. As we go through this description of this woman of noble character, in the Hebrew, this is each one of these verses starts with a letter of the alphabet. So it's designed to be an acrostic, if you will, the alphabet. And so some of these things, they seem disjointed, but that's the way it's following. And each one of these portrays the character of this woman. So we have the picture of this woman, who she gets up while it's still night. When everybody else is still sleeping, she gets up. She gets everything around so that when her family wakes up, everything is ready to go. I know that all you ladies are like that every single day. Well before the sun comes up, you are up there, you got the oatmeal and the eggs on, and the dishes are all done, and Ward Cleaver or June Cleaver looks at you and just cries. Right? So she considers a field and she buys it, so she's got a business set, she's out there earning money and making deals, and she sets about her work vigorously. Her arms are strong from her task. I had an aunt that was a work, she worked, they lived on a farm, and she was always doing stuff. That woman had a set of guns. Right? You never talk back to that woman. Yeah. And one person got that. All right, well, moving on. We'll try for two next time. All right. Thank you, Cheryl. I'll get your $5 later. All right. So he says about so her arms, and her trading is profitable. Her lamp does not go out at night because she's fully prepared. This woman is amazing. Just like all of you, right? Now, the men can't make those noises, only the women, sorry. So, she's just shrewd about everything, and her focus is on her family. But look at verse 20. Not only that, she opens her arms to the poor and extends her hand to the needy. Not only is she up before dark, doing everything that needs to be done before the family wakes up, is she not only taking care of business and doing all this, when she sees somebody in need, she goes and helps them too. Just like every one of you ladies. We appreciate you for that. See, helping the needy is a sign of righteousness. It's a sign of you're following after the Lord. Several times throughout the Old Testament, we'll hear about how Jesus or God brings wrath upon his people because they weren't taking care of the poor and the needy. It's an important aspect of following after God. So she's doing this. And verse 21 says that when it snows, she has no fear for her household. All of them are clothed in scarlet. In other words, they are well taken care of. She makes coverings for her bed. She is clothed in fine linen and purple. Her husband is respected at the city gate and where he takes his seat among the elders of the land. This woman makes sure that there's nothing lacking in her family and her husband. Because of all of her hard work and all that she does, her husband has a seat of eminence in the community. Just like every one of you. 24, she makes linen garments and sells them and supplies merchants with sashes. She has a business on the side. On top of everything else, she's got her own little side business going. She's incredible. Just like every one of you, right? She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and her faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. People come to her for wisdom. She looks ahead at the future and just laughs. I'm ready. Bring it. Verse 28:9 says, her children arise and call her blessed. Just like all of you. Her husband also, and he praises her. He says, many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. She is loved and respected by her family. Okay, ladies, there's my message of encouragement today. Go out and be just like her. See you later. I mean, this woman is perfect. You walk into her house and everything's gleaming and shining. And as I read through that, was thinking through that, she is the Barbie doll of the Bible. She is this ideal woman. And I never really thought about that before, but I'm glad I'm a man. Because, phew, that's a lot of pressure. I mean, it's in the Bible, right? So it must be what each of you is supposed to be. And if you're not, you're just not trying hard enough. So get out there and try harder. Have a nice day. Yeah, there must be something wrong with you. If you can't attain this, which God clearly lays out as a model, there is something wrong with you. And that is the lie that a lot of women fall into. They buy into this. And I'm just looking at this going, okay, so God, in his infinite wisdom and love for all of his creatures, put in the Bible these words to make women feel horrible. That doesn't make sense, does it? So there must be another reason why that's there. So let's take a look at this and figure out what's going on. Well, many people believe that this is kind of a composite. This is of many women. Because let's face it, God created each and every one of us, and he gives us gifts, amazing, wonderful gifts. But this woman has all of them, plus the ability to be in two places at once, apparently, because she's raising kids and doing all these things. So I believe it's a composite. She's someone to be aspired to, not a standard to be met. I believe that's the best way to view this scripture. Aspire to use the gifts that God's given you to his glory. This whole idea that she is something to be strived for and a standard to be maintained is in what is it? 1 Peter 1:16 says, for it is written, be holy because I am. We're called to be holy. How many people were holy on Tuesday? Wednesday. I'm sensing a pattern here. See, we are to strive for holiness. We are to be, we don't attain it until Christ comes. We don't attain it until we get to glory. But that doesn't mean that we should say, well, I'm never going to be holy, so just give up. We are to be striving towards it, working towards it. You should not be the same person today you were last year because you are now closer to the Lord. We are to be working, striving, growing in the Lord, to be closer to the Lord. So this idea that we can strive towards something better is perfectly, acceptable, especially when we understand that it comes from embracing God's word, seeking to live obedient to him, and to turn away from the things that are hindering us from doing that. That's what growth is. That's what it means to be genuinely transformed. See, we are called to be transformed, and that transformation has to come from the inside out. That's true transformation. So many times we want to take it from the outside in. Well, if I look like a Christian, if I look holy and act holy, and people think I'm holy, then I'm going to be holy. That's where we get legalism, and we get a lot of really nice people who look like they're Christians but are beating each other up in the parking lot and fighting over the color of the seats and stuff like that. Transformation has to come from the inside out. And so that means we have to embrace the Holy Spirit and embrace God's Word and invite Him into our life and say, change the things that need to be changed, and then willingly allow that to happen. Because what happens is we say, Lord, change me. And the Lord will convict us. Well, don't do that. Well, go love your neighbor. That jerk! What else you got? If we're going to change from the inside out, it's work. So we need to be striving towards this holiness. We need to be striving towards these ideas. What happens, like we talked about, when we buy into the lie that Satan gives us. Well, if you're not like that, ladies, there's just something wrong with you. You're not doing it right. You're not godly enough. God doesn't love you. You obviously aren't following Him, or else you'd be up at the crack of dawn. Instead of sleeping in until 6:30, I know. So, we buy into the lie. And we allow that to rule us. And when that begins to happen, we begin to look at these areas where we're failing at. They become the focus. We don't focus on the accomplishments. We focus on the failures. Oh, I can't do that. Oh, I'm never going to be like that. I'm never going to be cool as so-and-so. Ever walk into somebody's house and meet somebody and you think they just got it all together and you think, man, I wish I could be like that person? We let that begin to rule us. And instead of striving to attain, we just accept it and we turn away from it. Well, that's too hard. So we fall short. What we need to remember, and I think that what these verses are ultimately going to call us to, is that it's true. I'm never going to be all those things. But in Christ, I can have victory over these things. In Christ, He can give me the strength to be the things that I'm supposed to be all that He's called you to be, to take the gifts that He's given you and use them for the betterment of your family, for the betterment of others. When we turn it from what's wrong with us to what's right with the Lord, amazing things begin to happen. He gives us victory over sin and temptation, victory over Satan's lies. That is why Christian disciplines are so important. It is so important that we read our word every day. It is so important that we bow our head and we pray to the Lord every day. It is so important that we fellowship together. It is so important that we are quick to identify sin and turn from it. Because when we do those things, we begin to grow. When we begin to grow, we begin to become transformed. When we begin to become transformed, we begin to appreciate the wonder and the glory and the majesty of Jesus Christ. And we just want more and more, and we strive for more and more. So we're back to this woman who does all these amazing things. So where do we find hope and encouragement? I mean, because if you read this and you're looking at it from the point of what you're not compared to what she is, wow. But the beauty and the wonder of Scripture, the beauty and wonder of God's love is He's the God of hope. He's the God of encouragement. And so where do we find encouragement in all of this? Well, we go back to Proverbs 31 and we look at the last two verses. It says, charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting. Man, is that not true? Charm is deceptive. You ever meet somebody and you just think they're the nicest person in the world, and as you get to know them, you realize that they're really kind of mean and underhanded? But when you first meet them, they're just, it's deceptive. And you can't be charming, you can't be real for all that long. If you're trying to get by on charm, you're not going to get into very many long-term relationships because it's just not going to work. And beauty, are you going to count on your beauty? Beauty's a wonderful thing when you're 17, 18, 19, 25, 35, if you've got enough plastic surgeons, 72 according to Joan Rivers. But it's fleeting. If your beauty is what you're going to get by on, you've got a short season there. So charm isn't going to get it, beauty isn't going to get it, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. See, that's the key. The key is to love the Lord with all that you got. That's what beauty is. There's true beauty in a person trying to follow the Lord. There's true beauty in a person seeking to live righteous before the Lord. Let her works bring her praise at the city gate. Honor her, it says, honor her for all that her hands have done, and let her works bring praise. A godly woman is to be honored and praised for all that she's done. A woman of noble character is more precious than rubies. So let's think about that. If that's the most important attribute, then what is it that this scripture is calling us to strive for? Well, if you take a look at this woman, and you think about it in terms of this woman who brings God praise, a woman who loves the Lord, this woman's focus and energy is on others. Everything that she's doing for somebody else. She's not thinking about herself. She's thinking about her family. She's thinking about, she sees somebody in need and hurting, she reaches out to them. See, Christ didn't come to die, but for the other, right? Christ came to save the lost. He came to draw others to himself. Our God exists in a Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Each one, three persons, one essence. Each one interwoven within each other and a part of each other. And constantly in the other's business, if you will, but they're always, yet they're three distinct. And when we follow after God, our focus is immediately going to become on others. It comes away from ourselves and turns us to others. I look at it as when we are first born, our eyes are on the ground around us. We're focused on ourselves. And as we grow and learn and live a little bit, we begin to lift up and look around and realize, hey, there's a city here, and there's a country here, and there's a world here. When we have Christ in our life, we begin to open up our eyes and see that there are people everywhere who are dying for their sins that shouldn't be because of Jesus Christ. We begin to have compassion and reach out to people. So this woman is focused on others, something that we all can do. We all need to. I found this quote from a website, and I got the reference here if you ever want to look this up, but this is what it says. The only reason why Proverbs 31 woman can be perceived as perfect is because she's a product of God who lives within her. The only thing that's perfect about her is him. She doesn't place her hope in her husband, her family, her looks, but in God. Because of her fear of the Lord, she is able to be all that she is. You see, the Proverbs 31 woman is the ideal example of a godly woman, not because she's perfect, but because that all she does is resolve her relationship with her Savior. That's where her perfection is, her love for her Lord. Let's look at verse 1 again. It says, or verse 10, a wife of noble character, who can find her? I think we want to read that like this. A wife of noble character, who can find? Who can find a woman like this? But if we read that, then we're buying into all of the lies and we're looking at all the things that we're not. But I think it needs to be read, a wife of noble character who can find, well, this is what you're looking for. You're looking for a woman who is focused on others. You are looking for a woman who loves the Lord with all that she is. You are looking for a woman who is trying to live out her life honestly, genuinely, before the Lord. And it shows in everybody she meets. Everybody that she meets, everybody she comes in contact with, knows that this woman has a love that is out of this world. Is that something we are all capable of? It's something we're all called to be. And in this room, I see examples of ladies who are living out that. And it is a blessing to see that. And I encourage you to continue on. I continue to keep striving for the high calling of the mark of Jesus Christ. And not let Satan's lies about what you're not keep you from being what you're called to be. A woman of God. A beautiful, precious thing. Let's pray. Father God, I ask that as a church, you would help us to rally around the women of our church and encourage them to be faithful followers of you. I pray that as men of this church, that we would give our women examples to follow as we seek to genuinely follow after you. And as we do that, that we might be found to be a church of noble character, a church of people who love you, as we model that kind of life, that kind of love, that kind of obedience to each other, and encourage each other in the faith to be the men and women of God that you called us to be. Father, I am so thankful for the ladies of this church. I am so thankful for all that they do. I am so thankful that they are image bearers of you right alongside us. Father, help us to be your people. All that we say and all that we do, in every relationship we have, we ask that you, through your love and your mercy and your grace, that it would reflect your love, that the world might see and know that our Savior lives. Amen. I am so excited. It's Communion Sunday.